Good morning, Faith Church. We invite you to stand as we sing and worship God this morning. Let's praise Him together. On this beautiful Sunday morning. Anybody get any rain this weekend? A few people? Yeah? Well, hey, we are so glad that you are here, and we want to welcome anybody that may be a guest with us this morning. We hope that you feel at home here at Faith. We know we've got some folks that are tuning in online as well. We are glad that you are here, and we are just going to take today to open our hearts. Our prayer is that we would open our hearts to God and what He has for us this morning, for we are His chosen children. We are children of God. You have been forgiven this morning. So you have that. May we receive that this morning. Let's continue to worship.
Who am I? In my Father's house, there's a place for me. I'm a child of God. Yes, I am.
Amazing love that welcomes me, the kindness of mercy that bought with blood wholeheartedly my soul undeserving. God, you're so good. So good, God, you're so good, you're so good to me.
Behold the cross, age to age, and hour by hour.
You're so good to me.
Thinking about this, when I was a young Christian, I thought the things that we said in church, somebody wrote, like at a university or something. I didn't know where those things came from. And as I matured in my Christianity and studied, I learned that the Apostles' Creed was something that was written thousands and thousands of years ago. So when we say the Apostles' Creed, we're not just talking about what we believe. We're talking about what we believe with people that were thousands of years before us. They believed the same things. It gives us this foundation of surety in my mind. So today, we're going to together say the Apostles' Creed with all of those that have gone before us. Will you join me? I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he rose from the dead, he ascended into heaven, and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. You may be seated. And as you're seated, easy for me to say, I want you to grab the hand of somebody sitting close to you, your family or brothers and sisters. It's okay. You can hold each other's hands today. They won't bite you during church. At least let's hope not. Because I want to pray for you as brothers and sisters, as families, and I want us to feel that connection that we have. So will you pray with me? Dear Heavenly Father, as we come to you today to worship and praise you, we hold the hands of those that we love. We hold the hands that are our family. And maybe they're not our family at home, but they are our church family. And Lord, we come to you asking that you would unite us, that you would bring us together, that you would hold us in your arms as the one who we worship and praise today. Lord, sometimes the road isn't easy. Sometimes we look at each other and we're not sure that we really care about that person, but deep down we love them and we know that. So help us to be that family you want us to be, family at home and church family. We love you, Lord, and we lift up all of these to you today. In Jesus' name, amen.
Everybody, aren't you enjoying this sunshine after a weekend of rain? My God. Well, this morning, as we do, would you mind checking in on Facebook for those of you in the room and those of you watching online via Facebook? As well as if you're watching online via our website, go ahead and click the I attended button. Let us know that you're here and how many people are with you. This morning, I have a couple of announcements to make. The first one is that if you are the parent of a third through fifth grader and are interested in going to Carolina Creek this summer with us from July 14th through July 17th, please fill out our interest form so that we can see if we have enough to book for Carolina Creek. Many of you are familiar with this. It's a summer camp that we do in our children's program. Also, while on the topic of children's ministry, our third through fifth graders are invited to come back for midweek for 3 weeks in May. And it's going to begin this Wednesday on Cinco de Mayo. I think that's a great day to begin on a Wednesday. And so we're going to have tacos, bring $3, bring your Bibles, and bring a friend. Again, this is for elementary. Also, Faith UMC is looking for a pianist for our 9 a.m. service now that our beloved Miss Susan is retiring. If you or someone you know would be interested, please email Mr. Todd King with a resume, and you can find the full job posting on our website at faithumc.com/about-us. Also, we are looking for a few good men and women, really just about anybody, says Miss Cindy, anybody breathing to help in the AV booth on Sunday mornings, one Sunday each month. Our Sunday and video teams each need two more people to help. You will receive training and hands-on experience prior to committing, so you don't have to be a techie to be a part of the team. Please contact Ms. Cindy Wins if you are willing, interested, curious, or even want to volunteer a friend as tribune. So as you can see, anybody breathing, we need you in the back. Friends, there's so much life that's happening in the life of the church. There's so many ways that you can volunteer. So many ministries that are happening. And so if you would like further details about some of that that's going on, please make sure you stay in tune with our e-news and the website. Also, before the sermon, I just want to take a point of privilege as a proud husband. Many of you know my wife, Chantel Hobbs. This is my butter to my biscuit, the milk to my cereal, right? The sugar to my sweet tea, amen? And so my wife, we celebrated her graduating from seminary this past weekend. And so her program was at Dallas Theological Seminary. She attended the Houston campus, so we had that this weekend. Next weekend, we travel to celebrate her there. But y'all, this program takes about 5 years. She did it in 4. She went to winter classes, spring, summer, and fall throughout her tenure, dealt with a lot of life stuff, including COVID and loss of family members. And baby, I'm just proud of you. So congratulations again. Trying to get those points, fellas. Trying to get those points. Amen. There we go. All right. Well, if you all will pray with me, please. God, we thank you for another day that was not promised to us. We thank you for your goodness, your grace, and your loving kindness. Now, as we hear forth a word from your scripture, I pray you would hide me behind the cross and that you would comfort those that are afflicted, afflict those that are comfortable, and allow everybody to experience your goodness and grace. It's in your son's name that we pray. Amen. Well, parents of teenagers who drive, or if you have been a parent of a teenager who drives, there are 3 things you tell your kids do not leave the house without. One is a phone, the second is a purse or wallet, and the third are your keys. There we go, right? Those are the 3 things. Do not leave here without your phone, your keys, and your wallet. Always forgot one of those. Always as a kid, I forgot one of those. I remember one morning, I would wake up before my parents did. They got up 6:30, 7. I was 5:30, never ate breakfast in the morning because it was too early. And I drove myself to school. This morning, I couldn't find my keys, right? And so I'm looking in my bedroom, couldn't find them. My brother's bedroom, couldn't find them. I looked in the laundry, could not find them. And the last place I looked, because I didn't want to disturb my dad unless I had to, right? You don't want to wake up dad early in the morning. And so I went in there, rummaged around quietly, didn't find them. And what happens is, if I could not find my keys, I would need to ride the bus. Now, as an upperclassman, you know, you don't want to ride the bus anymore, right? And so I had to take the ride of shame, which was still fine. But I got to school, and you want to know where my keys were? They were in my football locker next to my wallet. Three things you're never supposed to forget when you leave the house: phone, keys, and wallet. I had forgotten two. Thank God I still have my phone. At least I think I did. But the reason I tell that story is not to illustrate how we should remember our phone, keys, and wallet, but it's to ask this question on Communion Sunday: how good are we at remembering communion? How good are we at remembering communion? And in fact, what is it that we are supposed to remember about communion, and what is communion in and of itself? And so today we're going to spend a little bit of time in scripture and talking about what happens in communion, as well as how we are called to remember it when we gather together. Jesus in Luke 22, as was read, he gathered his disciples in an upper room. And what happened is, as he was entering into Jerusalem, he sent some of his disciples before him and told him, "Find the man who is fetching water and go to him and ask to use his room." This was prophetic because normally it was women that would fetch the water, and so a man fetching it was a sure sign. The disciples found him, and they prepared the room, and Jesus and the rest of them joined together. And there in the upper room, he got to eat with his friends. He got to eat even with Judas, and there was laughter. And scripture says, after they recline, Jesus then gets up. He grabs the bread. He breaks it. And he says, "This is my body, which is given to you. Do this in remembrance of me." Then he takes the cup. We know the communion liturgy. He says, "This is my blood that was poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink of it. It is a sign of the new covenant." And what happens in this scenario is that God is creating a new covenant. But for us to really understand the significance and the importance of that, you have to understand the biblical knowledge or the biblical basis of covenants. If you've been studying alongside our very own judge, Walter Armatis, and his group in the Epic of Eden, this picture will look very familiar to you. There were five covenants in the Bible: the Noahic, the Abrahamic, the Mosaic, the Davidic, and the New Covenant. Five covenants that were in the Bible. You can take that down. Thank you. In each of these covenants, there was a representative or a mediator who represented humanity. There was also a sacrifice in a sense of an animal laid on the altar on behalf of humanity. Case in point, Noah, after he got out of the ark, remember 40 days, 40 nights, it flooded. After he got out of the ark, everything was good, everything was gravy, and then a few verses later, he has a barbecue. Now, can you imagine being one of those animals? You were just kicking it with Noah on the ark. You were just enjoying it. You were telling your wife, "Babe, I'm glad we got this room. We're not in the way below the deck. If you've ever been cruising, you don't want to be down there, right? We got a balcony." And next thing you know, a couple of days later, you see your cousin Alfred getting barbecued. It's interesting. It's ironic. But yet what scripture says is that God makes a covenant with Noah, and he tells him, "Listen, I want you to be fruitful and to multiply and to subdue the earth." And in that scene, you see that Noah took some of the clean animals and birds of the air and sacrificed them. The same thing happened with Abram. If you've been in confirmation class, you volunteered, or maybe you're one of the youth, you will remember that what happened with Abram is that God made covenant with him, and he said, "Listen, you are going to be a blessing to the nations through your seed. It's going to number the stars." And when him and God entered into a covenant, Abram fell asleep. And there in the middle of the sacrifice that he made, God's spirit comes in between. Confirmands, y'all remember that story? Y'all are quiet back there. Yes, thank you, Miss O. Yes, you do. You do remember. You definitely do remember. Yes. Not like we just asked you all questions about this. But Abraham, that was a representative for the people, and then there was a sacrifice of goats, rams, pigeons. Then we have the sense of Moses, right? I'm going somewhere with this. Moses is the representative. He stands on Mount Sinai and he creates a covenant with God. And God says, you will be my people and I will be your God. Here are the commands and the way that you need to obey me. And if you do this, I will do that. And there Moses takes young bulls. He cuts them in half. He puts some on the altar and the rest he sprinkles on the people. Do you kind of get what's happening here? This is important because humanity had a representative in Noah, Abram, Moses, David. And at the same time, something had to be sacrificed in order to ratify the covenant made. Friends, what God does at communion is he puts his power on display for all to see. God in communion through Jesus Christ displays his full divinity and full humanity. I'm going to show you right here. Jesus was a representative and mediator of the covenant that was made that day at communion. And at the same time, he was the sacrifice. Say it again. I know I'm teaching a little bit here. Y'all love to hear me preach, hoot, holler, stump, and everything. But sometimes we just need a Bible study, if that's all right. Jesus, Hebrews tells us, is the great mediator of the new covenant. And what that means is he stands in the gap for humanity, saying, I'm going to represent humanity in this contract with God. I'm going to be the great representative. But yet at the same time, that sacrifice that's required in order to ratify this covenant, I'm going to be that too. That's why the blood that is used in this new covenant is divine and is the propitiation or covering of our sin and lasts eternity. That's why this new covenant doesn't need to have a second covenant to follow it, because Jesus Christ has already provided the sacrifice for our sins. And what's interesting about this is when you look at Scripture, God has been having this great design all along. You remember Genesis chapter 3 in the fall? You remember Adam and Eve ate of the fruit, right? They were both at fault there. What happened afterwards, Scripture says in chapter 3, if we can put this on the screen, then the eyes of both of them were open and they realized they were naked. So what did they do? They sewed fig leaves together and made coverings for themselves. Notice, fig leaves is what they put together. Few verses later, at the end of that chapter, before God kicks them out of the garden, this is what the Bible says. The Lord God made garments of skin for Adam and his wife and clothed them. What is skin made of? What is skin made of? Flesh. So you see how since the beginning of time, Adam and Eve's sin, a sacrifice had to be made in order to cover that and to be back right with God. What does sin equal according to Scripture? Death. If you look at chapter 4 and 5 and the genealogy of Adam and Eve and you see all the people that live, the writer will tell you so-and-so lived 100 years and died. So-and-so lived 180 years and died. So-and-so lived 500 years and died and died and died. And what the author is trying to get you to see is that because of sin, death has now entered into the world. And what God did in the garden is he sacrificed an animal in order to cover those sins. And so when we get to communion table, no longer is it an animal, no longer is it anyone else, but it's God himself who sacrifices himself, who represents humanity at the same time, in order that we may have communion with him. And in this communion, we as Wesleyans, we don't believe that this is exactly God's body and blood when we come to the table. We're not saying that Jesus now, you can taste and see, right? Some of us know he's on vacation. He's not from Hawaii anymore, right? We've missed that a little bit. Some of you all got in it. We used to serve the Hawaiian bread. Jesus was very sweet. Nectar of heaven, all the goodness, and now he's just dry and brittle. He's a little smaller than I remember too, right? But it's not the case that this is actually Jesus, but it's that we are remembering him in this act and are thereby in remembrance experiencing some level of grace. Although we're looking at the Gospel of Luke, John says at the same time that they're experiencing the Last Supper, Jesus no longer looks at them and calls them servants, but in communion calls his disciples friends. The second thing I want you to understand about communion is not just the new covenant, but the fact that in communion, God has become neighbor to humanity and humanity has become neighbor to God. Karl Barth, a famous theologian in the 60s and earlier, he would argue that it's never the case that humanity reaches up to heaven, but it's always the case that heaven reaches down to earth, which means that we as individuals could never understand, comprehend, experience, or know anything about God except that it be revealed to us. And now in communion, we are able to see heaven revealed through Jesus Christ. Communion brings heaven and earth together and they collide because earth's great champion named Jesus Christ is also the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords that has descended into the world. We are now able to have a continual fellowship with God because God himself has sacrificed himself to make that possible. Are y'all with me? Are we still here? I have to make sure and double check because sometimes I know I talk kind of philosophical and that comes out from SFA and I know I have to speak a little slower for Sam Houston people, but just want to make sure y'all are with me. Amen. So now we remember not just the case that it is the new covenant and what that means and how it's those who confess with their mouth and believe with their heart in Jesus Christ, his death, burial, resurrection shall be saved, right? But it's also remembering that at the communion table, every time we come to remember this, this is the point when heaven touched earth and we taste it and see. But the third thing is, we're called to remember communion not just because of the covenant that was made, not just because we experience God in the midst of it, but simply because we're called to break bread with one another. We're called to break bread with one another. Y'all, there's so much that's happening in this world. We've talked about it. We've prayed over it. But what happened, I believe, is that somewhere along the line, some of us have forgotten how to break bread with strangers. Amen. Some of us have forgotten how to break bread with our families and our friends. Some of us have even forgotten how to break bread with God in our lives. You know, if you can't tell, I am a black man. Surprise, cats out the bag, right? Make some of you uneasy, right? It's like, oh, what is he gonna talk about? But I live in the uncomfortable and awkward. So I'm a black man. Everything that's happened in the news in the last couple of years since I've been here at Faith, it has impacted me. It's affected me. It does something to me as a black person when I see a black male lose their life and a police officer is involved. I can sit in that, wallow in that. I can be in community with other people who may believe that and look like myself and never fully understand the life of a man like Troy Nels or the life of a man like Sergeant Hanks or the life of any of our other police officers and those who back the boys in blue. And so instead of sitting in that place, by God's grace, I was able to break bread with many people that I didn't understand. And in that conversation, what happens is I got to learn their stories and they got to learn about mine. I got to share with them what it's like to be a black man in my shoes, and they got to share with me what it was like to be a white male police officer. When you sit down and you break bread with people, the labels get removed. The categories are no longer there. Because once you see somebody for who they truly are, you can never not see. Humanity is restored to people when you break bread with them instead of looking at them from a distance. and all the division that we've talked about, and the ways that maybe we live over here, they live over there, SFA, Bearcats, right? All the different things that we've talked about. Those who want to live in Harvest Green and Aliana, and those are, well, we don't have neighborhood tracks, right? But we don't have neighborhood wars. But it's important to do that, because when you break bread with people, in a way, you are remembering communion. You are remembering what God did in communion and how he gathered those together. And even if you don't like somebody that you're breaking bread with, even if you can't stand them to your core, it just unnerves you. It makes you want to lose your religion, right? Remember, Luke is very particular to say, before this whole pericope we looked at, or section of scripture we looked at, he said, Satan entered into Judas, who then had a conversation with the high chiefs and priests. And then we see this scene and where Judas still is. I'll say that again. Satan entered Judas, conversation with high priests. Judas is present in the upper room. We're still called to break bread with people we think the devil might have gotten a hold to. Something happens when you break bread. In fact, the walk to Emmaus, many of us have gone on it and we've support that. You know, Jesus was there walking with them, revealing scriptures from Old Testament, New Testament, all the historians of old, et cetera, et cetera. They did not see Jesus until he stood behind a table and broke bread. So my sermon to you, my point to you today for this week is simply this. For those of you that like to sit on this side of the room, I want you to break bread with somebody who sits on this side. To those of you who are in the middle, why don't you just pollinate amongst each other? Break bread. For somebody that you don't really agree with and you want to understand further, like, what in God's name made you do X, Y, and Z? Or what is it like to be a single young mother or a single young father, or in this place or this demographic, this category? Go and break bread with somebody this week, because when you do that, you will see God and remember communion. I'll leave you with this scripture. It's from Revelations. It says this. Christ will say, "Here I am. I stand at the door and knock. If anyone hears my voice and opens the door, I will come in and eat with that person, and they with me." That was in Revelation. What God does in communion is he comes in, he eats with humanity, humanity eats with him, and he calls us to remember that and to do the same, because we need to extend hospitality to this world. There's too many categories. There's too many disinherited. There's too many other. Why don't you break bread with somebody? In the midst of it, you may experience Jesus. Will you pray with me? God, we thank you for what you've done in communion and the new covenant that was made. We thank you for being our great champion and the great representative of humanity, as well as the everlasting sacrifice and eternal sacrifice that covers our sin. We ask that you will wash us clean, O Lord. We ask that you will convict us to break bread with one another so that we can experience your presence among us. As we recall the prayer that your son taught us to pray, saying, "Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen."
Amen. Well, this is the time where I remind you to give of your tithes, your gifts, and your offerings. You can do that so in a variety of ways. You can go on our website, faithumc.org, and give online, or you can give in these baskets up front as you come forward for communion, and leave your offerings there. We are continuing on with our dollar club, where we ask you to give an extra dollar above and beyond what you would normally place in the offering plate. And we count up the number of people who are here across both services, and we give a dollar per person to for our missions department to step in and help somebody in need during the week. Your dollar club offering last week went to a young mom who's trying to finish up school this semester. She's got twins and is struggling to get by. And so we were able to step into her life and be able to purchase some diapers and formula for the kids. And they were very, very appreciative. Now, as we come to the table, you know, at the Last Supper, Jesus looks at the disciples. He says, I no longer call you servants. I'll call you friends. We are neighbors to Jesus. And we're neighbors with each other. And so as we gather together to come to this table, we acknowledge that. But before we come to this table, let us pray this prayer of confession together. Merciful God, we confess that we have not loved you with our whole heart. We have failed to be an obedient church. We have not done your will. We have broken your law. We have rebelled against your love. We have not loved our neighbors, and we have not heard the cry of the needy. Forgive us, we pray. Free us for joyful obedience through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Friends, hear the good news. It's the best news you'll hear today. That in the name of Jesus Christ, you are forgiven. In the name of Jesus Christ, you are forgiven. Glory to God. Amen. On the night that Jesus was to give himself up to be arrested, to go to the cross the next day, he gathered his disciples in an upper room, and he shared a final meal with them. And over the course of supper, he took a loaf of bread, and he gave thanks for it. And he broke that bread, and he gave it to his disciples, and he said, take and eat. This is my body, which is broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me. When supper was over, he took a cup. He gave thanks for it. And he gave it to his disciples. And he said, take and drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in remembrance of me. And as we remember these mighty acts of Jesus, we are reminded of the mystery of faith that God presents us with. And it is this, that Christ has died, Christ is risen, and Christ will come again. Will you pray with me? Gracious Heavenly Father, pour out your Holy Spirit on those of us who are gathered here and on these gifts of bread and wine. Make them be for us the body and the blood of Christ, so that we can be for the world the body of Christ, redeemed by his blood. We pray this in your Son's precious and holy name. Amen. If you're assisting with communion, will you please come get into place? As they do that, a few instructions. The ushers are going to release you row by row. You're going to come forward, and you're going to receive double cups. The bottom cup contains a wafer. The top cup contains the juice. You'll go back to your seat. Once everybody has been served, we'll then take communion together. If you are in need of gluten-free, that is available here at the altar. This is Jesus' table, by the way, not a United Methodist table. So you don't have to be a United Methodist to come and to partake in communion. You just need to want more of Jesus in your life, because he calls you friend and wants to break bread with us. Well, friends, the table is set. Jesus is ready. Won't you come?
Before I took a breath, you breathed. so, so kind to me.
Body of Christ broken for us. It's the blood of Christ shed for us. be to God. And will you stand as we sing our final song? Being here today. On your way out, so Texas Roadhouse contacted us a few months ago and said, hey, we'd love to appreciate your church. And we thought, there's not a better day to do that than on Communion Sunday. So they're giving out their famous rolls and butter just to say thank you for being around. And so make sure you grab a box on the way out, because we want you to break bread with somebody, okay? So go forward breaking bread with one another. But let us close with our Wesley Covenant prayer. I am no longer my own, but yours. Put me to what you will. Place me with whom you will. Put me to doing. Put me to suffering. Let me be put to work for you or set aside for you. Praise for you or criticize for you. Let me be full. Let me be empty. Let me have all things. Let me have nothing. I freely and fully surrender all things to your glory and service. And now, O wonderful and holy God, creator, redeemer, and sustainer, you are mine and I am yours. So be it. And the covenant which I have made on earth, let it also be made in heaven. Amen. Go forward in God's peace. See you next week.